with a big round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. He's here to share the Tata Consultancy Services story. And here's the clicker for you.
This is forward. Okay. Hi, folks. Good afternoon. That was really slow. My voice was bigger than your combined. Good afternoon. That was definitely better. Hey, folks, an honest confession, I'm not a motivational speaker. It's not that I didn't try to become one. I did try once, and I did one mistake. After taking the session, I asked the participants how it was. And they all said, we all felt we were pushed into a prayer room. So that's when I gave up, and I thought I'll do whatever I think I'm good at. I would rather become a practitioner, learning practitioner. So that's what I am. I'm a Chief Learning Officer of Tata Consultancy Services, and I'll just share with you what we have done, right? What we have done, if I brag about it, that's what corporates or, sophisticated people call it as best practice sharing. So bragging for me is best practice sharing for them. So that's what I'll try to do, okay? But first, there is a lot of discussion about instructor-led learning, online learning, blended learning, okay? And what is better? So I'll tell you a small story. When we were small children, rather when I was a small child, I think I should not assume the age of everybody. When I was a small child, if a child returns to home after, playing hard and feeling hungry and asking for food, mother would typically say, it'll take about half an hour and go back to basic, cut onion, vegetables, and fry some noodles or poha, and then give something that will stay in your stomach. So that's what is the answer to hunger 30 years ago, 40 years ago. Now you ask a conventional mother, I'm hungry, mother will say, just 2 minutes and bring nagi noodles. You know which noodles I mean? I don't want to be sued, so I said nagi noodles. Right? So, online learning is like nagi noodles. So, you need to learn something quick, get online learning. So, with that little background, let me tell you what the real learning is and how learning stays and how learning gets applied so that as an individual, the professional grows, and also the company also gets some benefit out of this. With that, here is my first slide. You can argue whatever you like. Bloom's taxonomy is the Bible. You know, if you read, very unlikely that you will remember something. If you remember something, it's very unlikely that it will stay with you. But if you apply, you remember. So that's always true. And the highest form of learning retention is if you can really create something, okay, that will stay with you and learning will be, permanent with you. That's how I remember how to make kites, because I made kites myself, okay? So this is what is going to stay. So any learning framework that pushes some content to you and makes you learn and then not compel you to apply, I think that's not going to stay with you. It's as simple as that. How we apply, we know it as students. We remember things from books, and whatever we could not understand, our professors helped us to, understand, and we did well in exams and we got out. But the learning actually stayed if we took that extra effort to go to labs and do some practice. That's how we retain learning for a little longer time. And that habit, if it carries to project environment where you actually take the other steps of learning, then you actually become a much better professional. That is how the learning cycle works, whether you like it or not. And if you really want to have reading or online surfing as your primary mode of learning, then you will remain in a shallow world. You will learn and then forget. We call it as learn or learn, relearn, all old wine in new bottle. So that's what will continue. If you have learned something properly, it will be very difficult to unlearn because you don't need to unlearn. I think you have internalized it. That's what is my philosophy of learning. Now, the thing is, I told you that practice is necessary. And the best example of practice that comes to my mind is the way Guru Dronacharya used to practice, make his pupils practice. Because he not only emphasized what to learn, he also emphasized how to learn. We talk it as behavior, learning behavior. And you know the story behind that little picture. He called all his students and asked him to, what do you see in front of you? An average learner or poor learner saw, I see a tree. And a better learner said, I could see a bird as well. And the best learner, who was Arjun, who said, I can see only the eye of the bird, nothing else. So that's how Dronacharya taught his students, his disciples, to focus, to concentrate, to kind of see what you are supposed to see and make other things irrelevant for you. So that's how he taught behavior. So that's the best example of practice I can give. Now, the point is this. When your learners are like this, in an organization like this, our TCS, in 50th year, it has more than 400,000 employees spread in more than 40 countries, and they speak more than 100 languages. So where do you fit the Gurukul? How many places? You might fit, probably, if you have resources, you can construct Gurukuls. Would you have Dronacharya to run these universities or Gurukuls? Because the learners and the guru, both are important in the ecosystem. That's why wherever you have an Arjuna Award, you have also a Dronacharya Award. So how do you make sure that you can get the ecosystem right for companies like this is a big question. I think that clue also comes from, the same world of Mahabharata. I think this guy, Ekalabya, actually figured it out, how to manage without guru. You know that story as well. So Dronacharya refused to take Ekalabya as his student, and Ekalabya was pretty respectful. So he actually fired guru. He said, I don't need a guru. But he was pretty respectful for the guru. So what he did a idol of guru and started learning on his own. Okay, this is what our modern folks say, this is self-learning, self-learning, or anytime, anywhere learning, because he made place independent, time independent, and that's what is the origination of anytime, anywhere learning. So, 5 ways of learning, 2 way is so straightforward, anytime and anywhere, right? So, if you are really kind of in a mystery what these 5 ways means, 2 of them are anytime and anywhere. It's as simple as that. And this is as simple. I mean, Ekalabya had said, anytime, anywhere learning is possible. Now we make such a big deal out of it, right? Now, the point is this. Not everybody is an inspired learner like Ekalabya. Okay? If everybody is inspired, probably you will not require a guru. We are dealing with average masses. Okay? Self-inspired folks can probably learn on their own. I will not discount self-learning, but we are dealing with average learners, average people. It's all about getting the mean up, getting the mean capability of workforce up. So that's what is the challenge. So you have to deal with people who are not self-learners. You need to have gurus available to train them, and you need to get the mean capability up. What is a realistic solution to this world where you need the learners who hesitantly want to learn, you need a guru, even if he's not in place, can still connect with the learners. And then you have all the forms of learning. You call it as micro-learning, non-learning, instructor-based learning, blended learning. These are all just terms. You need to provide all this environment to the choice of individuals so that they can learn. Here is a solution for which we took credit ourselves, because not because of the novelty of the concept, but the scale at which we have deployed. I will explain this chart a little bit to you. A, when you talk about anytime, anywhere, that's where the concept of global calendar comes. Do you have the programs in a framework that is available to global audience? Okay, LMS 1.0 or 2.0, what folks were talking just before this. Okay, global audience, aware of the program, irrespective of the time zone, irrespective of the place. So that's a key. Now, second thing I said is that online learning, you totally don't have to discount. I think any learning program you take has some content that can be self-consumed. You know, you don't want to use classrooms for which it is not supposed to be, and don't not use classroom for which it is again supposed to be. So that is where you need to have the distinction, disseminate content online, or make reference manual, curate the course in such a way that there's plenty of self-reading available so that everybody is compelled to come to a level platform when they come for actual discussion. Best use of time, best use of resources. Then SME can be anywhere, can be in his or her office, or also can be in front of a large audience that I have shown it there. Okay? And the environment should be able to hook up to a practice environment. I said doing is important, practice is important. In this case, it's about teaching how to disassemble and assemble a computer. So lab is also integrated so that if one learner is practicing, every learner is able to see it and also practice it in their environment. It could be a learner, it could be the SME himself, or it could be a group. So that environment needs to be integrated in the anytime, anywhere learning infrastructure. Now, talk about the role of technology. I think the previous panel did a fantastic job of actually putting technology in its place as the enabler. So technology enables all this. And then what you do is, you can connect to any location that is geographically active in that particular time zone and connect to the workplace. It could be in Trivandrum, it could be any parts of the country, and it could be also any part of the world. You can see all the learners across the globe can participate in the same environment, can ask questions, can zoom up and then participate. You know, body language is visible with absolute, almost close to, as close to this kind of environment that we have stimulated here. So I think it's pretty lively. We call those as iClass, intelligent class. We have about 25 to 30 of them in India, quite a few in overseas. We have invested tons of money in this. I think it's a fantastic framework. We have the patented framework for this. We have a patent for this. And that's what is our pride, iClass. The iClass are typically high class. It's pretty good, okay? So it's not that there was a discussion again, behavioral attributes cannot be taught in a classroom sessions, right? I told, I can't put classrooms everywhere in a company like TCS. We use iClass for behavioral training as well. Here is an example, behavior training happening in Mexico with our faculty from India. So that's how it works. So pretty impressive framework, and that has actually given us the scale of technology and scale to the learning process. And we know that Human touch is important for learning. SME Connect is important. This is the framework which ensures what we call as high-tech human touch, replaces high-touch human touch. So this I thought I would share with you, which actually is a more nuts and bolts approach to anytime, anywhere learning. Now, next thing, big question is that, do you have the programs that actually cater to the needs of everybody. And I will tell you one powerful story about this. You have heard about, you know, business pundits, so-called, whether it is AI-based or human, kind of expertise-based, folks making statement that by 2020, 30% of workforce will become untrainable. Heard about this? You know, universities are not producing the type of talent that can be trained. You know, 50% of graduates are not trainable. I mean, these are most demeaning and disrespectful, you know, statements a leader can make. You know, humans are supposed to be the most intelligent species for which, you know, evolution is attached to human beings. And, you know, you hear this kind of disgraceful statements. The slide is it my problem or? No, I think we are okay. So, we are a company. We are a company, I think the animation will come. So, let's get it right away. So, we are a company. Our previous CEO said, we only have, this is the reason I was not clicking actually. I will stay on this slide quite for a long time. You can give little time. So our previous CEO said that we have only legacy technology, no legacy people. Everyone can be upskilled. So we take pretty lot of pride in this statement. And see, this is what is the solutioning for what our CEO said. Everyone is trainable. So in this simple slide, I can guarantee there is something in this slide for each one of 400,000 associates in TCS. We have piloted it, okay? I wrote in our internal social platform that I'm just throwing this in front of you. These are the names of different programs, and each one of you can subscribe to these programs and learn something, at least for a period of couple of years. Not a single hand went up saying that I don't have anything in this, okay? So, you can click pictures, but I will really encourage you, there is nothing confidential in this, okay? I will really encourage you, if you represent a company, take it and try to copy it. All it means is, create programs to cater to everybody's need in the company. Don't leave out anyone. That's why we call it as inclusive learning pyramid, and inclusive means anyone can participate in the learning process. So anyone, that's the third A. Okay, of learning. So, after this, I'll tell you the remaining two are easier. Remaining two stories are easier. And you have heard about this. Lots of hype about any device. I don't have to really exaggerate it. It's as simple as that. You carry a smartphone. You know, better put it to better use other than, you know, kind of doing gossip and spending time on WhatsApp. That's what it is. So, anytime you are creating a learning content, ask yourself the hard question. Is it really truly mobile enabled? Is it really giving the streaming experience of a big screen? If the answer is yes, you feel good about it. And if the answer is not, you truly feel guilty. Don't just to create checkbox, don't say we have all mobile enabled content. I have rejected quite a few companies because they say all our content are mobile enabled, but they are not, right? So, that is what is a simple question. You have nice kind of frameworks available, technology available to actually produce mobile-enabled content. Make sure that contents are mobile, assessments are mobile, and streaming is a little easier. You know, do not consume tons of bandwidth, making it easier for everybody. I think it is easily done. I don't have to really over-explain that any device part, but any content is something that I would like to throw some story. Now, anybody who says that, self-learning, you just type out a simple phrase, how to hit a six, okay? You will see 1 million hits. You know, absolute, trivial, and chaotic answer to probably Yuvraj hitting six sixes in one over. All kinds of, but what you know is how to hit a six. You want to learn how to hit a six. You need to understand it. you can hit a six in many other things. You know, you want to understand how to hit a six in cricket. So all that stuff, when you have to zero in, you actually need an instructor. Otherwise, you will go and spend a lot of time in the internet without really figuring out anything. Similarly, you might have a lot of online content provider. You need a good engagement with those content providers to really find out what you get, what you need. You get the best value for your investment. And there is somebody who is helping you in kind of curating your courses so that you don't waste too much time for yourself as well as for your learners. That's very key. That's what I said. That's what good gurus do. That's what Dronacharya was doing. That's what good SMEs do. And that's where, you know, L&D departments will have to work very close with the business experts and actually get the best SMEs aligned in the learning process. Otherwise, again, you will leave the fate of learners to the service providers or the partners and waste a lot of time, everybody's time. So that is where any content is absolutely key. What I have shown you is a snapshot of our internal learning assets. You know, free formatted learning is okay, time pass, but we want learning to produce results. So we have targeted courses. We push a lot of folks for certifications. Once they have a certification, you have something in the resume. I think the learning gets targeted. Lots of labs, hands-on environment. Again, I will come back to learn and then practice and internalize. Otherwise, it will not stay. So all those things are actually form the so-called gamut of any content. So any content does not mean that any content, it is pretty much nicely targeted content. So that's what I would say, any content and on delivered on any device. So these are 5A. Anyone can learn anytime, anywhere. Using best of content, and I call that as any content, on any device. That's what simply is 5A. Now, when you do all this, this is one slide I'll talk about our company, bragging about our company. All these things that I said is pretty much common knowledge. What we have done as a company is, you know, learning days is just an outcome. People are learning more. So we get those number of days going up. 15 days of learning is pretty much the, you know, best you can afford to. Industry average is about 5-6 days. So we are pretty good there. We are also like 10 days or below 10 days few years ago. But now we have made learning such a democratic process that folks learn on their own. I think our numbers are looking good. But next two are really key. You have, on an average, every individual, again, I will go back to the same pyramid. Using the framework of that pyramid, which is intuitive, you know, which can make the learners self-directed for learning, you know, on an average, 8 competencies per year, you know, average to complex competencies. So if you have that kind of learning culture, why would you say that people are not trainable? You know, that's what I would ask every pundits who so quickly write off the capability of humans. So this is real story. And certification, again, certification doesn't have to always be an accelerating, because certifications eventually translate to competencies and things like that. Competencies is more important than certification. This is the final slide I would leave with you. What kind of footprint we are leaving? 4-5 years of time, next 5 years again will look different. I constantly tell that learning is such a thing that will never allow learning to be in a steady state. Constantly things will change. So 5 years ago, our environment was classroom, instructor, and anybody who wanted to learn had to come to a classroom. And 5 years later, this is integrated learning experience where we have learners anywhere in across the globe, instructors anywhere across the globe, technically stimulated and enabled, and giving a fantastic learning experience, producing results. That's the footprint we want to leave for the company. And I'll tell you, next 5 years, how much of that will be AI-enabled, machine learning-enabled, time will say. Okay? We have also embarked in those journey. We'll use everything that is available. Nothing will write up. We need everything. And that's the type of integrated learning experience we'll create. Now, one last thing I'll talk to you, which is not related to 5A, but it's about a C, important C. It's about culture. How do you create a culture? That is where, actually, everybody needs some help, learning culture. And we take pride. We have an internal social platform called Nomi, which is pretty democratic. Anybody can write anything on it. And I realized very early that if I really have to influence folks for learning, I better be active on this. And I will tell you, I'm the most active member there. I constantly write and share ideas and take inputs. That's my primary way of taking inputs from our population. Very recently, I think it's pretty hot. Yesterday, I posted about something called this so-called Me Too. Me Too is going on now, right? It raises alarm in you. I wrote about it. And I narrated a little story from my personal life. My daughter was 14 years old then. She's now a doctor, 27 years old. And when she was 13, 14 years old, once I was taking a shave in the morning, and she appeared in the mirror from behind. She said, "Dad, can I go to school in another bus? Or maybe our driver uncle can drop us in the school?" And I said, "Why, what happened?" She said that, I'm being harassed by two boys. I said, "You know, what do you mean? You don't like to be teased by boys?" So she said, "Are you serious? You know, joking? It's not a joke. They're touching me inappropriately." Then I said, turned back and I said, "Do you want me to go and beat up those two boys?" So she was silent. And I said, "Look, you have to go in the same bus. Changing the bus will not solve your problem. It's very likely that in the other bus also there will be two similar boys, right? And going in the car is also not a solution because you have to live with boys. Boys will have to live with girls. That's what is going to be your future world. So you can't go in a car. So go with the same in the same bus. This time when you go, right, sit in the middle of those two boys and tell them that, look, this is the time to study. So let's study, let's play together, let's have fun together, let's cry together. But what you are doing to me is not right. So let's be friends, good friends. And when the timing is appropriate, we'll talk about relationship. This is not the time to talk about relationship, not the time to make mischief too." Okay? So she looked at me, smiled and left. And she came back in the evening with a very good smiling face. And never I heard about this problem later on. Because I'll tell you, that day I taught her to shout, "Hey, you too!" Now, rather than regretting with a "Me too" later. So that's what is about changing culture. I write about each and everything in our social platform because the next generations might be always online. They might have small attention span. Who said they have small? In my college, I also had small attention span. The professor was not good. I lost my mind. It's not attributed to generation. If we had cell phones and the distracted devices that time, we also would have behaved like that. It's not about generation. It's more about passing on the right learnings from generation. Okay, so that's what we do to create the learning culture. And I think everything seems to be working all right. So that's all it was for you, 5A. If you remember, I thought it was worth it. Thank you.
What an absolutely fantastic and insightful session, ladies and gentlemen. I think the last story especially deserves a louder round of applause. Thank you very much, Damodar. Thank you very much.
I'll get unwired.
And talking about social media, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for joining us and taking this conversation that's happening in the room on Twitter. Continue.